Let me start by saying, draw the limits. Two or three things we can neither do nor have to do. There are things like that. And I will explain what I mean by giving examples. India, at the moment, has something like 300 universities. I'm not counting the private universities now, which have started recently. I have no data on them. Out of these 300 odd universities, at least 50 to 60 have departments of music. They teach classical Indian music, both of the North Indian variety and the South Indian variety, Karnataka music. Some of the universities are, some of these departments of music are at least 70 to 80 years old. But in these 70 to 80 years, till now, they have not produced a single great classical musician. They have produced teachers of classical music. They have produced hundreds of PhDs who know music, if not music, at least musicology. The only person I can remember who is kind of respected little bit as a musician, Prabhat Ray, also has a PhD in music. Now here, I need hardly tell you that the lessons of this are obvious to everybody, including aspiring musicians, that you cannot learn music through a university system of the kind we have. If you want to be a good classical musician, make a vocation out of it, you have to go to learn it in the traditional manner to a guru, an elder classical musician who will take you on. And the course probably will last not less than 20 years. So, in some sense, this is one area where you don't have to do anything at all. You don't have to talk to them about resisting Western system of education, Western knowledge, Western... the things are so obvious. There is an obvious... You know, we know that we are not required. So Indian classical music, like one or two other disciplines, can survive on its own without our help. I once was told by friends that all classical musicians seems to, doctor friends, all classical musicians seem to survive for 90 years. Probably they're happy in their vocation, whatever. Classical musicians and those who see, are into classical studies, Sanskrit, Persian, in a lot of Indian universities still have courses in Farsi. They all live up to 90 and they don't expect any patronage from you, any support. They won't understand what we're talking about. They live in their own world and perfectly self-content. Let me give you another example of a slightly different kind. At the turn of the last century, in the early years of 20th century, there was a clerk in the city of Madras working for the Port Commission. He used to get a salary, if I remember correctly, 30 rupees a month. He had this idea that he knew mathematics. without learning it. But he was exposed only to an old school textbook written by an English mathematician. And he modeled his work on what he learned from that. He did not know anything about proofs, how to prove a theorem, how to prove an equation. So he would do is to write down his equations, what, you know, once he was satisfied that it was correct. And where did he get these equations from? He used to dream that the local goddess Namakkal would open her tongue, it would roll out of her mouth when he was sleeping. And on that tongue will be written these equations. So when he would wake up, he will write them down. So convinced of his abilities and his mathematics, he began to send these equations to well-known mathematicians. At that time, in the high noon of colonialism, universities meant Oxford and Cambridge. So all the mathematicians there were accustomed, they were world famous. That was the citadel of mathematics globally then. And they were famous mathematicians, they were accustomed to receiving letters from cranks who would claim that they have solved great mathematical puzzles lasting for 300 and 400 years. So the first two he sent them, they were English gentlemen after all. They just repacked them and mailed him back to this man. Then he sent it to the person who was probably the best known mathematician of the time, G.H. Hardy at Cambridge. And Hardy had a look at the equations, and he later wrote in his autobiography that he felt that some of them were known. Some of the equations were known. There was nothing new in them. And some of the equations were obviously wrong, or seemed wrong. And some of them he couldn't recognize, but they looked strangely convincing. So he was convinced that there was another crank trying to cheat him and claiming a new discoveries. And he went on to take his classes during the day. But those equations haunted him. He being a mathematician, he began to calculate the odds of this man being a thief, a cheat, and felt that somebody of this incredible intuition to write so apparently convincing new equations, along with equations which were known and which were obviously passing off as new, the chances of his being a crank or a cheat was less than the chances of him being an unknown genius. And he began to work on them. And that's the story of discovery of Ramanujan, the Indian mathematician, later recognized as the greatest natural genius in mathematics in 300 years. I once did a psychobiological biography of him. And one of the things, I was young, I was fresh from a clinic, psychological clinic, psychoanalytic clinic. I thought I knew all the answers once. And I soon found out that there are mysteries in life for which there is no direct explanation either in social sciences or even in speculative philosophy. But that I found out later, when I was older. I am afraid, in fact, the things which were known, which he has done, he had on his own discovered the discoveries of people like great mathematicians like Riemann and others. But that's not the point I'm trying to make. I'm trying to say that about that also we cannot do anything. Such natural geniuses will break through existing barriers, and we can neither promote them nor protect them after a point. They will have to be on their own. I could have given examples from some of the child prodigies in music too, and so on and so forth. But that's good enough. So first, my first proposition is this, that we here have some limitations to us too. But beyond that limitation, there are also very specific issues that we have to address. And many of these issues have been addressed already. It is also my feeling, and there I come to my second proposition, that we cannot approach the issues we confront, the historical injustices, the enormous cruelties, the genocides that are strewn around us, in our memory at least. We cannot confront these, I believe. We can, why not? Some people do it as a form of exorcism. Exorcism, ghost busting. There's something within us, a position. The West is like a position, and we have to now exorcise the ghost in within, take it out. That's what Franz Fanon actually argued. That Fanon's plea for violence was actually a plea for cleansing. He argued for the cleansing role of violence
in the wretched of the
earth, as a way of getting out of the clutches of the West. But, and this I have argued elsewhere, there are problems out there. There are two kinds of problems which I can straight away tell you. I do not have much time, so I learned from the experience of Mira also in the last session. So I will try to be more, ration my time better. One way is to...
God is very free.
Let's see. So what I was going to say was this, that the two kinds of consequences of that. One is the one which Fanon himself almost unwittingly states. It describes in the same play, book, but little somewhere else, and it doesn't connect it to his final proposition about the cleansing role of violence. Shows that the torturers who tortured the Algerian freedom fighters gradually got sucked into their role. And they became not only torturers for the Algerian prisoners of theirs, but also to their own families when they came back. Gradually, the degradation and the dissolution of their personalities were not missed by Fanon, who by his profession was a psychiatrist.